Welcome back, guys. Today we are going to take a look at 2018 psychological horror film called The House That Jack Built. The movie begins with a preface from a man who narrates five incidents from his life over the course of 12 years. First incident. Along a deserted road amidst the forest, we see the protagonist named Jack driving towards his destination where he gets stopped by a woman whose car has a flat tire. She asks for his help as her car jack is broken, but Jack stays cold to her requests. Nevertheless, the woman doesn't back down and annoyingly convinces him to drive her to the blacksmith named Sonny, who can repair the jack. Thus, they drive along, but the woman talks excessively along the ride and calls Jack a serial killer. He ignores her until they reach the blacksmith's workshop. Even there, the woman doesn't stop blabbering as Sonny welds the jack. After it's done, they return back to lift her car, but the iron breaks again. Jack is severely exasperated as the lady begs him to drive back to Sonny. But on their way, she agitates him to a boundless extent and calls him a wimp. Anger fuels his actions and he lifts up the car jack and smashes it in the woman's face. After the blackout, a background conversation plays between Jack and another man. On screen, Jack talks about the famous pianist Glenn Gould and further proceeds to justify his murder as a form of art. Just as cathedrals were built upon using materials, the car jack was the material for the art of murder. Now that Jack is an engineer, he explains how he wants to build a house on a land of his own. Moreover, he states that he suffered from compulsion since childhood and has OCD. The scene then shifts to a street named Prospect Avenue, but its plate has been broken and defines only prose. In the street, there is a walk-in freezer in which Jack drags the body of the lady. In the cold storage is a door that he never managed to open, so he leaves it be and proceeds to put the body to safety while wielding some braces for the chamber door. Later, he cleans his own van and hides away the lady's car in the woods where it cannot be seen. The second incident. The second incident begins on a road where Jack stalks a woman walking along. She enters her house and she's right out of sight. Jack walks to her door and tries to enter it by feeding her a story that he's a policeman. The woman asks for a badge, but Jack keeps giving lame excuses to support himself. She doesn't comply, so he eventually gives in and states that he's from the insurance and he could double her pension. Upon hearing that, she lets him enter the house, where he tries to gain sympathy from her, but exposes his evil side later on, as he tries to strangle her from behind. The lady begins to choke, and Jack starts whimpering as well. He makes a drink and feeds her, but his devilish side takes over and he strangles her to death. He later assures her demise by stabbing her in the chest. Jack then puts her up on a chair and snaps her pictures in a pose. After completing his crazy venture, he wraps her dead body and drags it to his van. Putting it safely inside, he runs back to the house to wipe away all the evidence and blood. As he succeeds, he returns to the van in order to leave the area, but his OCD and compulsions take over as he imagines that there are some stains still left in the house. Therefore, he runs back inside to check on it and continues for a long time in his mind. During his to and fro runnings, a police officer arrives there, which makes Jack dash back into his van and hide away the body in the bushes. The officer inquires about his presence, upon which Jack narrates a story that the woman is missing. The police officer goes in to check the house and Jack follows him. Inside, he successfully manages to trick the officer by speaking too much. The officer asks him to leave, which he does indefinitely. Outside, he takes out the dead body and ties it with the rear end of his van. In his hurry, he drives away as the dead body gets dragged behind him, leaving a massive trail of blood. However, as he reaches the isolated Prospect Avenue, Jack notices the blood trail. But somehow, the luck turns to his side and it starts raining heavily, eventually cleaning off the bloody tracks. Upon that, Jack imagines to have to hire a protector, but in reality, he's just a perverted Satan who analyzes the scraped skull of the woman. After, his psychotic nature is explained that Jack is completely devoid of empathy. During his childhood, he used to hide in the reed fields and then watch the farmers use their scythes in a rhythm. As a kid, he watched them potentially and then catches a duckling in his net. Even as a child, he performs savagery by brutally cutting off the duckling's feet and throwing him in the pond. Jack's sole purpose is to feed his compulsions and justify them as forms of art. He does so by engaging with a woman romantically and then eventually strangling her to death in a calculated method. After finishing up the task, he drags her to the walk-in freezer and proceeds to take the negatives of the photos of all the victims. He brings death upon another old lady who walks down a dark road at night. He runs her over and puts her dead body in his car. With the background talk still going on, he justifies it by Blake's poems, mentioning how lamb is innocent and how the tiger is represented for savagery. Jack considers it all an artist's nature and proceeds to take the dead bodies to his apartment, where he snaps their pictures together in various poses. Afterwards, he names himself Mr. Sophistication and sends the photo to a newspaper. Being done with that, he explains the importance of the negatives of the photos and how he was mesmerized by them as a kid. At that time, he finds the demonic quality of the light, the dark light. The next scene pops up where he builds a model of his house and later goes to his construction site to analyze all the aspects of the building in progress. Amidst all this, he explains how he walks between his own shadows and he needs to kill in order to fulfill his compulsions, otherwise nervous factors start to shadow him. The third incident. This specific incident covers the aspect of Jack's life where he has a family. With a wife and two young boys, he travels to the open forest area to practice rifle shooting. His little boy named Grumpy stays back while the elder one named George stays with Jack and becomes interested in watching the weapons. Jack explains the rifle and the shotgun and they climb to a tower where George presses the trigger. Jack takes him to the shooting board and explains how to kill an animal. Furthermore, he mentions the old trophy tradition of hunting. Although Jack has found himself a family, his psychopathic nature doesn't end there and his lack of sympathy makes him compare his family to a herd of deer without order. So, to maintain his order and solidarity, the ruthless man begins to shoot his own family members from atop the tower. The kids run scared as their father targets them one by one. His wife screams in terror, grief, and agony as her kids die beside her. As for her, Jack counts to 12 and lets her escape, but his ruthlessness gets her and he shoots her down in a ditch. Concluding that, the madman collects dozens of hunted crows and his own family members as the hunting trophies. The tragic event aroused Jack's aggression and he tears down his partially constructed house in order to change the material. In anguish, he breaks away from his models of the house as he can't seem to derive an answer from his confusions. After, the camera shows yet another satanic version of Jack where he goes into the anteroom and tries to change the expressions of Grumpy's dead body. The hooks and the procedures turn the kid's corpse into a hideously menacing smile child, and Jack claims him to be a credible human being. The fourth incident. This incident covers Jack's story about the romance. We witness him getting out of the car using crutches to pretend to be harmless. He passes a police officer and goes to meet a beautiful woman who seems overwhelmed and scared by his presence. To get her at ease, he goes to the other side of the room and talks to her via telephone. She shares her insecurities about him leaving her, but Jack reassures her that he isn't going to leave. The reassurance calms her down and they start to get along well. The girl gives her name as Jacqueline, but Jack states her as Simple. As they talk, Jack claims that he's a serial killer and has murdered over 60 people, which Jacqueline refuses to believe. Jack ignores her innocence and proceeds to undress her to trace circles around her breasts. The awkwardness of the moment causes Jacqueline to get up and leave. She walks out and talks to the police officer who is parked outside, but the officer simply refuses to believe her. In the interim, Jack also walks out and claims that he's murdered over 60 people. The officer considers them drunk and leaves the scene. On the other hand, Jack cries in a corner and gains all the sympathy from the innocent woman. He apologizes to her and she forgives him, so they go back inside where Jack lays asleep. Jacqueline tries to call for help but finds out the phone cord had been cut. She tries to flee the apartment but Jack catches up on her and threatens her. He forces her to scream for help, which she does, but nobody comes for her rescue. Jack even shouts himself and goes to the window, but no one hears their pleas, ultimately extinguishing all hope for Jacqueline. To put an end to her, Jack overcomes her and ties her up with the phone cord. He uses a knife to operate on her body and the scene blacks out with her screams. Later, the psychopath Jack walks out, thrusts a cut-off breast on the police car, and leaves without any resentment. After all this, he explains his admiration for artworks preceded by a demolition and deconstruction called the Noble Rot. The formation of the best wines, the creation of the iconic buildings, and the destruction of his own timber house once again. Amidst all this, Jack talks with a man called Verge and debates on the value of icons. How the airplane named Stuka was made to enforce terror on the enemies due to its screeching sound as it dived. Jack admires the sadistic nature behind it, and Verge debates with a story of love, humanity, care, and dignity. Unfortunately, Jack refuses to accept it in his nature and proceeds the final act where he buys some bullets from ammunition and gives the payment from a pouch made out of human breast flesh. The fifth incident. The final showdown shows that Jack is getting help from Sonny in order to prepare an iron stand. As it's prepared, Jack takes one of his victims at gunpoint and leads him to the walk-in freezer where the other victims are already kneeled and lined up on the iron frame. As Jack aligns the new guy in front of them, it is revealed that he is conducting an experiment of his own and trying to check if he can shoot through the heads of all of them with a single full metal jacket bullet. As he lines up the rifle, the new guy states that it's not a full metal jacket bullet, which enrages Jack, and he drives back to the ammunition shop. Upon reaching the store, he forces the guy named Al to give him the actual rifle bullets, but Al refuses to give it without the ID or authentication. After having a massive row, Jack leaves in anguish while Al returns to the phone and gives the call to the local police. On the other hand, Jack drives to a secluded area and runs down the road where his van gets stuck. He then gets out and runs to a caravan to meet an old guy named SP. Just as Jack enters the van, SP pulls out a revolver on him and makes him sit down. Jack begs for a full metal jacket bullet, but SP doesn't listen and calls the local police to inform them that he has captured Jack. To tone it all down, Jack uses a strategy and talks about their old times together in order to melt his heart. Just as SP lowers the gun, Jack thrusts the knife up into the old man's throat and kills him. Afterwards, he proceeds to steal the bullet from his collection. In the meantime, a policeman arrives at the caravan from SP's call, but Jack murders him as well and steals his police car to return to Prospect Avenue. Once back inside, he confirms that it's a full metal jacket bullet and proceeds to take aim from the rifle, but it doesn't focus. During this, the police arrive in the street. In the meantime, in order to fully aim at his victims, Jack needs to move the rifle back, so he breaks the lock of a huge door and opens it to another chamber. In there, he focuses through the scope to aim at the victims' heads, and just as he's about to pull the trigger, he hears someone call his name. Upon turning the light on, he faces an old man clad in black, who introduces himself as Verge. He states that he's always been here since the time of the murders and reminds Jack that he needs to build the house. Furthermore, he urges Jack to find the right material for the house. That motivation sparks the psychopath and he uses the strings and wires to build a house of all the dead bodies he acquired. Once completed, Verge admires his build and invites him inside where they enter a hole in the floor and the scene fades out. Epilogue, Catabasis. This storyline depicts Jack and Verge floating seamlessly in the water. Later, they fly in a bubble and end up in a cave submerged in water. In the cave, they hear a buzzing sound which Verge denotes as the wailing and cries from hell. Afterwards, they enter another gigantic chamber of the cavern, where they lower down the ladders while the background is sprawling with thousands of dead bodies. With that, they both pass through the localizations of hell and the blood-ridden paths into a boat amidst a raging sea. After crossing it, they appear in a battered building outside of which Jack notices the farmers plowing the fields with their scythes. Verge remarks it as the Elysian fields, which are out of their bounds. The memories cause Jack's eyes to flood with tears, and his mind revolves around the memories. Afterwards, the scene shifts to a cavern where they reach a broken bridge. Under it flows the red-hot blistering lava. Verge states this is the deepest part of hell, but Jack is not destined for it. Furthermore, across the bridge is the way out of hell. Jack listens to it and decides to climb the steep rocks around the cavern to the other side. Verge bids farewell to him, and Jack slowly begins to clamber along the sharp rocks. But as he reaches halfway across the path, Jack starts losing his grip. Eventually, he slips and tumbles down to the deepest, blistering pits of hell, ultimately putting an end to the film. Drop a comment below letting me know how you found the video. Make sure to like, subscribe, and ring the notification bell. Thanks for watching, guys!